5:30 p.m., so like to begin this caucus session of our council. We have one item under new business. Are there any recommended changes or additions to the agenda as presented this evening?
I am done.
I'm done.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to call this July 15th, 2015 council meeting to order. Would you please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, would the clerk please call the roll?
Mr. Dragish?
Yes.
Mr. Cosar?
Yes.
Mr. Morve?
Yes.
Mr. Rogers?
Here.
Mr. Tisch?
Here.
Okay, thank you. All of you have received a set of minutes from the June regular council meeting. Are there any revisions to those minutes? If not, they stand approved and on the record. Okay. Okay, under reading of communications, Mr. Tisch.
Communications.
Mr. Rogers. We'll wait till he comes back. Mr. Morbin.
Yeah, so, let me see here. The only communications I have, I've pretty much gone over with the city manager at this time. There's a business in the Anginetta's building that is getting flooded, of course, with this rain that we've been having. I think everyone's been getting flooded. But there seems to be some particular issues that perhaps we can get those resolved. So we're looking into that. The lights on the red lights on 224 seem to be different. Some people are complaining about the lights are long, they're only letting three cars in, whatever. I've gone over that with Joe, and so Joe's going to look at it and see if that can be resolved. And other than that, I don't have any.
Mr. Rogers, I'm sorry, you're out. Any communication?
Nothing.
Matt, goes on.
I have a very nice experience. I have a letter dated June 24th from a lady who had a very nice experience simultaneously. Maybe stealing some of the chief's thunder, but I don't think he would even make you aware of this. On June the 24th, our officer Dustin Cover got to the plaza up on top of the hill up there. A lady was having a reaction to an antibiotic to the point of not able to breathe and all sorts of things. And eventually was hauled off in an ambulance to St. Elizabeth's Hospital, where she spent 2 days. She had with her her 20-year-old autistic son. And autism touches me directly, so I have an appreciation for what was happening. This 20-year-old kid has autism as a student at Youngstown State. But people with this condition get rattled in uncomfortable situations. And Dustin Cover must have done an exceptional job because, and I don't want to read the entire letter, but I would just like to share this with you. I would like to personally thank Officer Cover for providing safety, order, and caring service to the city of Canfield, and more specifically to Ben. Under the circumstances, it was extremely difficult for me to leave Ben alone at Hilltop Plaza that night, but I trusted Officer Cover to care for him. Not only did he take care of Ben, but his actions and demeanor were very important positive impressions with police experience on Ben. In adults with autism, it is extremely important that they trust police and are not afraid to interact with them. Honestly, words cannot adequately express my appreciation and gratitude for the professional and compassion that night. I just thought that was nice.
Okay, that it? Mr. Warino.
Yes, a couple pieces of correspondence. I received a notice from the Attorney General's office with regard to the purchase of rock salt. The Attorney General has entered into a settlement of $11.5 million, This was first brought to our attention by WRN News, I think in one of the meetings when this had happened. They are asking communities that have been involved in the purchase of rock salt through the ODOT program to submit their invoices or billings for the period. And there'll be a core part, or I don't know how they'll, what formula they'll come up with, but hopefully we'll get some return on this. What amount that'll be, God only knows, but we've made our requests, or at least put our information together. It's been submitted to the Attorney General's office, and I'll let you know how we fare on that particular instance. I received a letter, and I think I put it in last week's memo, from the Land Bank in Mahoning County. They've been notified by an interested party on purchasing a parcel of land in the city, of which the city had spent money to demo the property. There's a $20,000 or $25,000 assessment on the property, of which $20,000 is for the demolition and the work that was done. They're trying to negotiate to sell that property and wanting to know whether the city would entertain negotiating down that $20,000 assessment that we have on the property. The only good I can see out of it myself would be that, you know, I don't know what type of settlement they're looking for, and certainly not 100%, I would hope, but you know, making that an active piece of property where the city can generate some revenue from it is a positive. But you know, we have $20,000 invested in it, and I'd you know, like to get your opinions on whether you want me to entertain a meeting with these folks or where we want to go with that. Something, if you can get back to me early as so I can respond back to the Land Bank. I appreciate that. And lastly, in correspondence, I received a letter from the Daughters of the American Revolution, and they have their Constitution Week coming up in September, and last year we did a proclamation, and they're requesting that we do the same thing for this year, and I hope to have that on next month's agenda. That's all I have under correspondence.
Okay. Under reports of committees, city managers, department heads, Mr. Rogers.
I am not that.
Mr. Morbe.
The fire district, as you know, is going to be building a new station. It's going to be located on Herbert Road somewhere. We've identified two pieces of property. One is in the township and the other is up the street a little ways. One is owned by the township and one is private. And so we're doing an assessment now as to the cost involved in the piece that the township owns would be a lease similar to the one on Messerly Road, which is $1 a year, but the excavation costs are pretty substantial. So in buying the private piece of property, it might behoove us, might be less expensive, might be more approval to do that. So so we're looking at that. We have signed a contract with the architect, which will help us through the step-by-step process of getting the station built. The two fire trucks have been ordered. I believe today we made a final decision on the final packages that the trucks are going to look like and specifications. And those have been approved. And the station will probably, at this time, realistically, be spring of 2016. So that's our target right now. There was a terrible fire on Shields Road last night. Glad to report that there was no fatality. However, it was a complete loss of the house. The gentleman tried to put the fire out himself, could not, got out of the house, ran to several neighbors, and finally found someone to call 911, and then we did respond, but the house was a total loss. And other than that, that's all I have to report.
Mayor Cozart. I have a report for the court for the month of June. We took in a total gross collections of $4,962.10. And after we paid the various accounts that were required to pay by law, we had net collections to the city of $4,171.10.
Thank you, Mayor. Joe?
Okay, thank you. I'll start off with yesterday's rain event. Our rain gauge here at the city building registered 1.17 inches of rain in about a 45-minute period, and we had a number of, I'm going to call it minor flooding areas, since nobody's basement that I'm aware of has been affected. We did have the one business that Councilman Morvay had spoke of earlier. They were hit pretty hard with the rain we had 2 weeks ago, and then got a second shot of it during this event. And the mayor and I have talked to one of the businesses in the area that we feel could avert some of that water or divert some of it into a closed system to get it out of the roadway and avoid his property. I did get up there and none of the work has been done yet. I haven't had a chance to talk to the owner, but in our meeting with him, I think you'd agree with me, Mayor, he seemed very anxious to help the neighbors out and get the thing done, but it hasn't been done as yet, and it may be because of the wet weather, wet conditions, I don't know, but I will follow up on that and see how soon we can basically extend the channel or the swell on his property to catch a lot of the runoff that's getting through the backyards and ending up in the roadway and then flows through this business on Cardinal Drive. If we can get it into a closed system, we can get underground and get it out of the street. So we're going to try and do that. We had a pre-construction meeting and obviously awarded the notice to proceed for the sidewalk project, and that happened in the morning. In the afternoon, they were out there taking sidewalk out. It's moving quite rapidly. If you've been over there, the north side of the street, all of the walk is out, and about 25 to 30% of the new walk is already back in, and they were working on driveways today. So that's moving along rather rapidly. However, we did have a glitch yesterday. They hit a underground tank at the Wirtz property, which was not identified or wasn't expected. And it appears at this particular time that it was taken care of. And maybe you would know, Chuck, the it's right up underneath the sidewalk, and they were looking for any records of how it was mitigated back however long ago. And at this particular time, my understanding is they did find some documentation on that, but I don't know for certain.
I would suggest you talk with Chief Hutchinson. I think Brother Bob was the chief when they removed the tanks there, and I recall there were, you know, a bunch of people around, and they were doing testing for leakage on the tanks that were there. Finding a tank, another
estimated
tank.
Estimated at about a 200 gallon tank that was right underneath the sidewalk.
Right under the sidewalk.
And it was cut and filled with sand and soil, so which is what they had done back 20 years ago. And we're hopeful that it's not going to cause any environmental issues that we have to end up with. But as I understand from the earlier conversation, it's under control and it was done properly, but we'll find out for sure. Next item up, the traffic counters. We had Eastgate put out on Timber Run. The first counts that were done, the first one was, well, the road was still being constructed and just incorporated all of the traffic that normally flows through that area, and it amounted to an average daily traffic flow of 610 vehicles. With Timber Run now open and Gibson Road closed, we had the counters put back out there, which means all traffic from both subdivisions are passing through the same area. It almost doubled. It did double and just slightly above. It's 1,290 vehicles a day. And as I mentioned, we're going to wait until Gibson Road is back reopened, see how people go back to their old patterns and how many continue to use that. We'll get another count, and then we can determine what further action we want to take on that particular. But it was interesting that it actually doubled. It was that close. I did get notification from MS Consultants that the bid package is now out. We have an August 4th bid date for the Chapel Hill drainage improvements, and I notified the property owners affected by that as well. They're happy to hear that news. We hope we can move on that as quickly as possible once bids are received. I mentioned the land bank issue. Well, last week, during Eastgate's Technical Advisory Committee meeting, they announced that the next round of traffic alternative program applications are due on August 31st. And that, if you recall, that's the funding source we used for the sidewalk project. And we were looking to possibly submit a project for the lighting along North Broad to accommodate our widening project. The one glitch that they added to the mix now is that ODOT is requiring all applicants to take an online 20-hour course to be able to submit the project, and they will not accept a consultant to represent the city. It has to be somebody affiliated with the city or the applicant that has to be certified under this LPA program. And I've applied for it. I'm going to try and get it done, but in a month's time, to find 20 hours is going to be pretty difficult. When we get certified.
You get a degree with that, Joe?
But it's, again, it, a lot of objections from the group, you know, that have consultants and city engineers, but the rules say that it has to be someone from the city or the applicant that has to get the certification. So we're going to muddle through that one. Also on during the same meeting, they announced the next round of Issue 2. The applications are due on the same date, August 31st. What I would like to suggest is our project this year would be the local share of the North Broad Street project, since it's been delayed and it kind of falls right in the realm of when the applications or the money will become available. That could, if successful in getting the Issue 2 money, could make that a zero-funded project from the city. So I strongly suggest making that our number one priority, and that would be for also the three roads that we're talking about resurfacing and the North Broad, which gets us up close to $500,000 in local share on those three projects. So that's kind of my recommendation, and I hope you agree with that. The next. I mentioned the salt already, okay. And that's pretty much what I had in my report. I just want to make sure. We had a groundbreaking during the last period for the administrative offices up at the Mahoning County Educational Services Technical College. They're looking at a $6.5 million administrative office that's being put up there, and we're excited about that happening in the city. That's a very good economic development project for us, and certainly will be a generator of revenue. So very pleased we attended the groundbreaking, and looking forward to see that project through. And that's basically all I have.
Mr. President,
yes.
If I might suggest the full council with regard to the Issue 2 application at North Broad Street, and manager direction on submitting that for our next project.
I would follow Joe's recommendations, and I agree with him myself.
We have to vote on that. I don't know that we have to vote on it. I think he wants direction, and I assume
absolutely of all our suggestions.
Sure. Okay. I'll proceed with that. And if there's any other projects, that we can always submit two or three projects, but that would be our number one, would be my request. So let me know if there's something else that comes to mind.
Thanks, Joe.
And the other reports, Todd?
One in June, we had one water main repair, two funerals, and other than that, we were busy repairing infrastructure, mowing, patching streets, and chipping brush from the storm that went through on the 11th.
Follow-up report, I think it was two council sessions ago, we talked about the Chase Bank robbery. We did receive a federal indictment on our suspect. He was charged with the bank robbery. So as I reported to you a few weeks ago, we did have our suspect. He was indicted on all counts, the Canfield robbery and other municipalities that were affected by his actions. So that did go through. Due to the alarming number of heroin and other drug overdoses, our officers will soon be trained in the administration of Narcan. Narcan helps to reverse the effects of certain types of drugs. This project is funded through the Ohio Attorney General's Office. However, locally, Sheriff Jerry Green has offered to supply us with the Narcan kits. They've also offered to train our officers, and we'll be facilitating that training to take place very soon. The Cardinal Joint Fire District has always carried Narcan. Fortunately for our residents, oftentimes our police officers arrive on scene sooner than this situation is taking place, which is, has happened. Our officers are going to be trained to administer Narcan. And as you know, the seconds count when it comes to saving a life. So. Also, I'd like to provide a report to you, a quarterly report. I have some statistics to present from April 1st through June 30th, 2015. Overall CAD calls, which are just general calls for service, 2,102 calls for service. Overall reports that our officers had taken and subsequently investigated, 103. 30 of which were property reports, 58 were person reports, and 15 were miscellaneous reports. So for a total of 103. From a traffic and arrest perspective, our officers made a total of 87 arrests. There were 672 traffic stops, 221 resulted in citations. Should be it. Mark?
Yeah, just a few items of interest. We're just starting to dig into the revisions we're going to have to make to our income tax ordinance relative to House Bill 5. The Ohio Municipal League has submitted a model ordinance. We may need to pull in some special counsel on this to assist us with this, because if you don't get it right and you don't have the correct ordinance in place by January 1st, 2016, all income tax revenue is then remitted to the state. So we want to make sure, we're just starting to dig through that process, but that's a big process. We recently cleaned up some non-compliance issues relative to previously approved PUDs, where a plan is submitted years ago, and then over time, things like buffer areas get eliminated, etc., and we've kind of got to step into that and make sure it's reestablished, because in those instances, PUDs and other areas that require a buffer zone, whether it be the natural existing buffer or a new buffer, they simply, in most cases, would never have been approved without that buffering. So over the years, or decades even, when that buffering starts being chipped away at, then we've kind of got to step in and have them reestablish the buffer. We're just starting to work through a new SRO agreement, which I'll prepare as soon as the city, the township, and the Board of Education agree upon its terms for the next school year. And I'm continuing to explore legal options relative to Timber Run Drive. I know Joe talked about getting the data and getting that to everybody so you can make an informed decision. By that time, I'd like to be able to tell you what you can do. So then I'll be happy to take any questions.
If I can digress back to the chief, I'm sorry. Chief, there's, I've heard of the break-ins.
I can't hear you back here.
Just in regards to the break-ins in the township. And so I was wondering if you had any insight to, were those all isolated incidences, or is this some kind of a gang activity, or do you know the specifics of it, of any of that? Or, and as citizens, what should we be looking for?
Knock on wood, we have not had any. We believe that they're isolated incidents. They've all taken place in the township, and it is happening. We're working together with the Montgomery County Sheriff's Department. And we do have leads in the cases, but we haven't had any to speak of in the city. But that doesn't mean that we're immune to them by any means. Suggestions for the residents would be, without a question, keep your cars locked in the driveway. I know that a lot of people fall in the habit of not doing that. I certainly suggest you keep your cars locked, also keep your doors locked. But I believe they're isolated. And we've had, in the past, similar situations. We've worked well with the Sheriff's Department, and we've been very successful in putting an end to it and making an arrest. So, yeah, fortunately, we haven't had any home burglaries, any car break-ins to speak of recently.
Thank you.
Yeah. And
I may, with regard to zoning, in June, we issued 10 permits out of the zoning office, a total evaluation of $7,653,000. And the fees that were collected based on that amount was $38,315. So it was a very unusual month to receive that much. Obviously, the biggest item was the work being done at the Mahoning County Career Technical Center, which that permit was around $34,000 itself, and the Arby's, which is being constructed up the road here, is at $3,753. Busy month.
Okay. Under persons desiring additional information from department heads, I ask that you step forward to the podium, state your name and address clearly for the record, and keep your questions to a three minutes maximum per person and no more than 30 minutes total. Your questions must only pertain to each department head's report this evening. Anyone? Under recognition.
Is that for people to speak, what you're talking about?
Next one. And that was it. No, that's it. This was for anything that the department has just mentioned right now.
Specific questions to the manager, the people here on with city manager, chief, Todd. Any specific questions to them that you have?
Yes.
State your name and address, please.
I just want to ask a quick question. Anthony Gutierrez,
you have to come to the podium so that we can pick it up for the minutes.
Anthony Gutierrez, 241 Lake Point Circle. In reference to the fees that you said you collected for these building permits, where do those fees ultimately end up being deposited? General fund? Or
those go into the general fund.
Okay, that's all I wanted to ask. So for now.
Thank you. Under recognition of persons desiring to speak before council, may I ask that you step forward to the podium, state your name and address clearly for the record, and keep your comments brief. Courtney Larson.
Courtney Larson, 170 Dartmouth. It's good to see all of you again. A quick update on the splash pad. We have had an overwhelming amount of support for the project, and an overwhelming amount of people that are already asking to provide funding and donations for it. We were trying to go through the process of becoming our own nonprofit to house that, but it's taking longer than we expected, and this amount of money is going to be a big endeavor. So what I'm asking for actually is if the city would consider opening a fund and earmarked a fund to specifically house that money, that whatever we raise would then be distributed directly to the city that you would then be able to have control of for that project.
Back quite a few years ago, again, Chuck, you can maybe elaborate, when they did the Todd's Town or whatever it was over at Griesel Park, the city I believe that was done with private donations, and the city had to pass an ordinance in order to set up an account to accept that money. In this particular instance, if we're in line with building a splash pad out at Fair Park, then we'd have to follow that same process of establishing an account. So if anybody does donate towards that project, money's going to be deposited in an account, and it would have to be done before we start accepting donations.
I think that's true. We would have to do that, and legal counsel would have to be involved to make sure that we're got all of our eyes on and T's crossed.
Yeah, for sure, and I want to get the an opinion from Christine, obviously, finance director, and she would probably want to get an opinion from the state auditor about the specific, because certain reporting requirements and audit requirements have changed since we did that.
Yeah, she was the one I spoke to first, and she said to come to you guys.
But conceptually, I think that's fine. I think where the rubber will hit the road here is that's going to be on city-owned property.
Correct.
Right? So I don't know if there's been any discussion about what this will end up looking like or what it will consist of, but you and your group may want something that the city may not be too fond of.
So. Right, and and nothing has been decided. I did meet with the Parks Board a couple weeks ago, and we're continuing the planning as for Fair Park. So I contacted the contractors to actually get designs, different designs of different sizes, so then we can further present, and we don't have anything set in stone at all.
Okay.
We're moving with this so that we can work.
Well, I think it's important that you continue to work with the Parks Board.
Absolutely.
And I'm sure their recommendation to the city would be great. And then I'll start digging into this in terms of some liability issues and insurance issues and what the waiver is going to look like that everybody's going to sign and, sure. and things like that. So I'll be happy to do that.
And I've been in touch with the District Board of Health and then the state as well as to find out for the cost of permits, so I'm trying to compile that as well, do a little research as well, so that it would be a little bit easier for you guys as well.
All right, great.
So, okay, thank you guys.
Question.
Yes.
If you're not going to have a 501c3
yes.
to issue a letter, would the donors be expecting to deduct this from their federal income tax?
I'm assuming yes, and I was assuming if the city housed it, it would be used under the same.
Okay,
sure.
Yeah, there's a couple of things about that. If it's going to be a donation to the city, obviously that's a tax-exempt donation.
Right.
Secondly, just because you don't have a 501c3 exemption letter or recognition, doesn't mean that the contributions aren't deductible.
You can't deduct it.
It just means that they're not per se deductible, and that the IRS has said, hey, you donate to this entity, here's a recognition of exemption letter, and income and contributions to this entity are therefore tax deductible.
Right.
That's not a requirement for deductibility. It's the gold standard, and that's big donors are going to want that most of the time.
Right.
But that's not the end all.
Right. Okay. And that's something I would ask your recommendation as well. We were planning on hopefully working with Christine, because I did speak with her, of keeping our own records of where we are, you know, in the fundraising process, and then being available to send some sort of receipt as well to those, but that we could work out the details as we.
The exemption process with the IRS pursuant to obtaining a 501c3 letter, that can take up to 18 months.
Okay.
Yeah. It doesn't have to.
I'm worried about the momentum because I'm having a lot of good response right now, and I'm worried if it takes too long that it's going to cut it.
Sure.
Yep, exactly. Sure. So we're just trying to keep it moving. But thank you guys.
Courtney, have you followed back up with Rotary? Because I know we discussed that.
We definitely have to submit a formal, but we can't take any. Even at the 4th of July, I had a table set up just to raise awareness, and everybody's trying to say, don't give me a dollar. We have nowhere to put it yet, so nobody give me any money.
Okay. So. We have a new president as of July 1st, you're aware of that?
Yes.
Okay, so you have her number and everything good?
Yeah, we'll be in contact. As soon as we know where it's going, we have a lot of people that are very, very interested.
Yeah,
yes. Great. So thank you.
Thanks, Gordon. Thank you very much.
Anthony Gutierrez?
I got a lot of material here. Okay, Anthony Gutierrez, 241 Lake Point Circle, Kentville, Ohio. I'm going to try to make this brief if I can, but that's not going to happen. Okay, first thing, I haven't been here for about a month. I've been pretty busy, but I've kept up on the meetings on the computer. The last meeting I clicked on June 17th, it said Kentville City Council meeting, but it was a mutual admiration society I clicked on, where somebody so rudely denied Mr. Nicky a chance to speak. And at the end of that meeting, I think you apologized to him. But anyhow, that's history.
Actually, we didn't stop him. We just told him to hold on, and then he decided to leave. So.
Pardon me?
We didn't actually tell him he couldn't speak. We just told him to wait. We were waiting until the council finished speaking, and then he left.
Okay. So he was kind of upset.
I understand that, but it was a misunderstanding.
Okay. I was requested to ask the city law director for his legal opinion as to whether or not the meeting held on April 22nd was a legal meeting.
You're asking me that now?
Correct. You can state it for the record, you can do the writing, it doesn't matter.
Okay. Then I'll get your opinion. I'll get my opinion to Mr. Warino, and he can provide it to you.
Okay, when would I be able to get that?
As soon as I can get to it, so probably in the next week or two.
Okay.
That's what meeting? What date?
April 22nd, a special meeting. It was not advertised. The Vindicator got noticed, but somehow...
It was advertised, the Vindicator, Mr.
President. It was advertised at a regular meeting.
Right, so, but it was actually presented to them.
Well, I'll certainly stay on the record tonight that, in my opinion, that was a legal meeting. I'll provide the reasoning and my opinion in writing to Mr. Moreno, and he can get it to you.
Good.
Okay.
The meeting, it was advertised as a regular meeting.
which would have been the third meeting of the month. And we only hold two regular meetings a month. So it was misadvertised, correct?
Not on our end,
though. Correct?
On the Vindicator's end, not on our end. Yeah. We, our end was actually advertised for
On the Vindicator's end.
Right.
Okay, that's what you meant. Okay. Go to another subject. In the last meeting that it was talked about, I have a lot of subjects we can get to in future meetings. It brought up that you bought 3 assault rifles, Chief of Police?
Suppressors.
They were suppressors.
Silencers?
Silencers.
Who, for the assault rifles, 3 of them?
Correct.
And the chief of police bought the assault rifles and the silencers?
Yeah, they what's your point?
My point is, if he's buying assault rifles and he's buying silencers, this guy's talking about body cameras for the police departments and a $500,000 building. Yeah, $500,000 building to store police evidence. This is not Chicago, Illinois. I'm concerned when the police department starts bringing in military equipment for its citizenry. It's a legitimate concern. Especially in a city that has little or no crime rate. Despite what you say, I gave you some demographics of the city.
Anthony, you and I could go round and round all night. You have your opinion, and I can have my opinion. And guess what? I read the papers, and
probably read the papers too.
Yeah, well, there's people shooting guns at one another. Okay? I want them to have the best equipment that they can have, and if that's an assault rifle, I'll give it to them.
Well, you're
that's my opinion.
You're not different, okay?
We do.
The police department, it's a service to the community.
It is.
Okay.
It is.
Well, we differ, okay? We'll leave it at that.
Might I respond as well?
Oh, sure.
These 4 members and myself of City Council set policy. The city manager implements policy. That's our job.
I watched your presentation on the strong council, city manager, former governor.
Do you understand what I just said?
Yeah, I understand.
Fine. Go ahead with your next comment.
You just repeated it. All right? We differ, okay? I don't think you need military-style equipment in a police department or community like this. And I think the majority of people would agree with me. Now, especially in a community that has little or no crime rate at all.
Guess why?
They just got through telling you no burglaries in the community for 3 months. I mean, I'm talking about
Campbell has a reputation. You don't come into Campbell and create a crime. You don't do it. Because we have the best police department in the area, Anthony. That's why. That's a deterrent.
Look, I beg to differ with you.
Fine. That's great. But I mean, we could go back and
we're overstaffed and an overpaid police department for this community.
That's your opinion.
Based on what information? What's your background that makes you able to evaluate our police department?
I'm a retired police lieutenant.
That's what I thought.
Okay.
Thank you.
In a city where they did have a crime rate. Now, I want to get to this salary ordinance. Maybe I'm misunderstanding this. On a holiday comes up, and a police department's working that, a policeman's working that holiday. He gets paid for that holiday?
Again, I don't believe this is a question and answer period. Well, I think he's supposed to, if you have something to comment on, you can make the comment and
that's be done. This is in relation to the salary contract that you guys agreed to, the proposed. Maybe you're reading it wrong, and maybe you can help it.
Well, if you want to make an appointment, I'll be glad to go over that with you.
Real quick here in about 2 minutes.
Now, this isn't the forum for that.
Well, as I read this, I'm going to read it.
An employee who is scheduled to work a normal week, regardless of holiday, will be paid by the 7th day of December. Holiday pay. 12 holidays. What I'm asking is, when they get this check in December for holiday pay, is it because they weren't paid for working a holiday during the year? That's a simple question. Because if they were paid during the year, you're paying people double for the same holiday, according to this salary contract. Now, am I reading it right? You signed it, you proposed it, you can explain it.
I'd be happy to do so. Well,
do so.
Make an appointment.
Do so. These people are probably interested in it too.
Anthony, this is not the forum for a question. I'm going to write this ad
in the newspaper, and I'm going to pay for it prior to this election for the city income tax. We'll see what the people of the community think. You can't get any answers from you guys.
You can. Just make an appointment. You can have any answer you'd like.
No, I'm not going to make an appointment.
That's how the city works.
I'm part of the group that's called the employers.
Yeah. Anthony, have you...
These are the employees.
Anthony, have you made an appointment with Joe?
No, I don't intend to.
No. Why not, Anthony? Have you been in to talk to him prior to this?
I just asked you guys signed this.
Second.
You wrote it up, you guys signed it, maybe you can explain it. Did you read it before you signed it?
We know exactly what we signed, Anthony.
Huh?
We know exactly what we signed.
Then explain it.
Here, 220 Gladview. I hope we can make this go pretty quick. First of all, fit people who are here, put your pencils down, because public comments don't get covered very well anyway. In regard to the, a few comments in regard to the staff reports, Public Works, excellent. Thank you. Thank you for giving us that information. Police chief, I think that's great. These people you see like to know what's going on. We've got a good police force, and that only really reinforces it. Thank you. I'm glad to see we got a zoning report. I think we missed one too. One thing that a couple of weeks ago there was a little bit of mischief in my neighborhood from some juveniles, and unfortunately I was included in this mischief, and the police responded quickly, and I thank Steve Marista, did an excellent job. Thank you for me. The finance reporting, I think, in this meeting have been at least something to be desired. I seem to have to extract the information one bit at a time. I think we should have more data. For example, I've asked how much money is in the general fund. Nobody can tell me. So let's make that a part of the report. I've talked to the city manager about this, and I hope we can get more financial information in this report. We had a charter amendment recently that allowed for these people to be there. Let's take advantage of that. Let's tell people what these departments are doing. The administration, in my opinion, appears not to want to put this information out. We're trying to increase our city income tax, but we're not sharing the information as to where the money is. It makes me wonder.
Right.
Yes, sir.
At any time, we've gone over this and over this and over this, at any time a citizen wants information, can simply walk in, address himself at the desk, go up and talk to Christine, talk to Joe, talk to Chief, talk to Doug. It's all open. It's an open book, Frankie. The information is there.
John, you missed the point. I want it to be public in this meeting. That's the point. More open financial information. Okay. Let me move on. At the end of the last meeting, Ms. Matisse was reading an article about city government. An excellent article, I might add. I thought I could add something to that conversation at the end of the meeting. I raised my hand and I asked if I could comment. Mr. Rogers came through with a resounding no. By what authority did he say no? Do each of you have a unilateral authority to say no? That appears to be the case since no one said anything. After a while, Mr. Teach, to his credit, invited me to speak in regard to that subject. And he told what I hadn't said. But after that insulting no, my comments would not have been pretty. So I declined. The mayor also tried to smooth things over. Thank you, sir. Now, this hubris was not a standalone event. A few months ago, there was a budget hearing open to the public. During a discussion about new police cruisers, I asked if I could comment. The city manager said no. This was supposed to be an open meeting to the public. What right had he to suppress comment? I thought the public was invited for that purpose. Apparently this administration wants people to shut up and sit down. It ain't going to happen. One of my pet peeves, and I'm going to bring it up again, add insult to injury. You, citizens who are attending here, might have noticed that in the lobby there are signs that say stop. City employees only. Only authorized people beyond this point. Signed, police department. This building belongs to the people. Why the insulting and intimidating threats? There's a public bulletin board in the hallway leading down to the city manager's office. But it lies beyond no man's land. You do not have access to it. Free access. The city manager has opined that the signs are for safety. Does anyone believe that a sign enhances safety? There's something wrong with a government that fears its people. No, the signs are there to insulate the people who we pay from the citizens, the taxpayers. Instead of being a city hall, it now resembles a Gestapo headquarters enforced by the police. How about a sign that says, "Welcome to City Hall"? Seems to be much more appropriate sign.
Insist on drawing this line that we are the bad guys. I mean, do you really think that we are bad? Do you think we're crooks and
criminals? That is your conclusion, John. Some of your decisions don't make a lot of sense, however.
It is just to stop people from wandering through to anywhere they want to go in the building. It's just to stop them from checking in. That's all it is for, Frank.
It is an intimidating sign, and just for the record, for the people who are here, I proposed a sign that said, "Welcome to City Hall. Please sign in at desk with the receptionist if you want to see a city official. Thank you." Isn't that a whole lot better than saying the police are going to come after you if you cross this line?
It doesn't say that.
That's what it says. Right?
That's what it says.
That's what it insinuates.
That's what it
says. It's your insinuation. That's not what the public is thinking.
You folks go out and read it on the way out. Tell me what you think. Okay. In the last three general elections, my last one, there were 6 charter amendments on the ballot. Let me remind you that council opposed all 6. Let me also remind you that all 6 passed. It should be said that the administration is out of touch with the electorate. It sort of reminds me of a line from the movie Cool Hand Luke. What we have here is a failure to communicate. But in this case, it's a failure to listen. In closing, I would like to paraphrase, if I can, Mr. Morley, one of your comments. I'm tired of it. Okay, print people, pick up your pencils. Thank you.
Frank, yes, sir. Before you leave that podium, I want to correct my colleague. You can't come in here anytime you want and go up to see those people. Those people work.
Actually, they work for him, not you.
I agree.
How to betray a trust, Frank. I hope you don't think any less of me.
Never.
For those of you that don't know, this individual and I go back 60 years. 60 years. Went through engineering school together, went through ROTC together, became Army officers together. And I listen to Frank out of respect for a 60-year relationship. I don't think I've asked you this in confidence, but I have asked Frank, run for office, run for council. All the answers are here. Sit up here with us. I've even offered, I'm a lame duck mayor, and I'm done with this at the end of 2017. I might make a good mayor. I don't know. He's going to need an attitude change. Frank, you're on the outside trying to make it better. Come on the inside and make it better. Everything you ask for is available to you. Be responsible for things that are going on here. You're looking at five, I'm going to exclude myself, you're looking at four very good people on this council that are very, very good people, very knowledgeable people, and we're doing one heck of a job. I want to grab onto their coattails and take a little bit of credit for it as it happens. But we are just sick and tired of you coming in here and calling us everything but, never mind. Frank, come on the inside and help this city improve itself. Don't walk out in frustration. I'm not sure he ever was a policeman. But that aside, boy, when he reads that, you know we're going to hear it in the next council meeting. Frank, I'm appealing to some higher sense within you to help us. Don't hurt. You're hurting us.
I appreciate your comments. I'm not trying to hurt anybody. I'm just telling it the way I see it. Now, in regard to office here, General, let me reply to that. I'm getting, in my opinion, more done on the outside than I would on the inside. For example, suppose I was sitting here and I said to these gentlemen, hey, I think we ought to have term limits. They could throw me out of here. I think if it weren't so old, I would.
That's the dumbest thing we've ever done. Look what you got for a mayor. You okay, should be sitting here. He was a great man.
Good, you get some bad, you know. But I feel I'm getting more done. Let me tell you, I put a lot of work into these charter amendments. Each year, 2013, 14, and 15, I put 100, 125 hours into those things, as well as my own money, in some cases, a lot of my own money. But I'm getting to the point where I think some younger people ought to be there, like this young lady here.
Yeah.
Would be a more positive addition than this old guy. But anyway, you didn't betray any trust. Everybody knows you're both two old guys. And we have a lot of scars on us to prove what each does for you.
Frank, I think you could contribute sitting in one of these chairs. I think you could contribute if you helped us educate the people who are going to vote on August the 4th as to what the real needs are in this city. You have a following. You have power.
I don't know about that.
Political power.
I don't know about that. If I do, I certainly didn't try to get it, that's for sure.
Frank, I don't like you so much that I make that up. You do have power. Help us make this city a better city.
I think what I've done in regard to these charter amendments has done that.
I love your expression, in my opinion.
Well,
I think it sucks.
But again, my intent is sincere.
Turkey, you want to push.
Yes, I guess we're straightforward.
I know this thing as much as the next person does, and I'm trying to help and do things that I think are for the benefit of the people of town. Thank you much for your time.
We'll come up for you, Frank.
I'm sorry.
Frank, I will come up for you, Tom. I want to clarify one thing about this. We've given you the opportunity to speak quite often. We have. But you've been able to speak often here, okay? And there's times you can do that. Like right now, you're talking way beyond the time we should limit, but we let you do that, okay?
because councils let you do that. When I stopped you, that one bus council, we were having our time where we give our comments all progression here, okay? You wanted to break in there and comment. That was the time. After we're all through, if you wanted to say something, that's what Mr. Tisch said, fine. I would have no problem at all. You broke the chain of progression here. We have here. We have every council meeting. You wanted it your way, Frank, and that's why I stopped you. You can talk anytime. We let you talk. But there's a time to talk and a time to listen. Okay?
My comments were at the end of this conversation.
No, it wasn't. You stopped our progressive meeting. That was why, Frank, and that's always a why. You can talk. We let you speak, Frank.
That's not how I proceed to speak, but anyway.
Well, okay. You can see the difference. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Okay?
And a lot of the time I took up tonight was because of questions from here.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, folks.
Thanks, Frank. Under old business, there is none. Under new business... As for the provisions of section 4.05 of the Charter of the City of Campbell, I move the council dispense the requirement of two readings, the proposed ordinance and authorized adoption as the same upon its first reading. Do I have a second?
Second.
Mr. Morvay?
Clerk, please call roll.
Mr. Dragish?
Yes.
Mr. Kozar?
Yes.
Mr. Morvay?
Yes.
Mr. Rogers?
Yes.
Mr. Tisch?
Yes.
As per the provisions of section 4.05 of the Charter of the City of Campbell, I move the council dispense the requirement of a full reading of the proposed ordinance and authorized reading by title only. Do I have a second?
Second, sir.
Mr. Rogers.
Discussion.
A discussion? Clerk, please call the roll.
Mr. Dragish?
Yes.
Mr. Kozar?
Yes.
Mr. Morvay?
Yes.
Mr. Rogers?
Yes.
Mr. Tisch?
Yes.
Okay, Mr. President, I have an ordinance to approve and adopt the current replacement pages to the codified ordinances. I move for passage of this ordinance.
Second. Second by Mr. Tisch.
And Joe, if I may, these now conform with the current state laws required by the Ohio Constitution, and that's why we're amending them, correct?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Public comments? Clerk, please call roll.
Mr. Dragish?
Yes.
Mr. Kozar?
Yes.
Mr. Morvay?
Yes.
Mr. Rogers?
Yes.
Mr. Tisch?
Yes.
Thank you. And the number is?
2015-22.
Thank you. Okay, we're on to council comments. Mr. Tisch?
I have no comments this evening.
Mr. Rogers?
Well, I can go on and on, and I too all smell. I'll pass tonight. Nothing. Thank you. I'm just too wound up right at this point.
Mr. Morgan,
I love this city. That's the reason I sit here. And I said this before. You know, we don't get benefits here. Health benefits. We don't get retirement benefits. We get $100 a meeting. And any one of these guys sit here because they love this city. We're not out for our own agenda, our own concerns. We are not the good old boy network. And you can criticize perhaps some of the decisions we make, but they're made collectively and they're made as a decision to move the city forward. And I disagree with Frank, and Frank knows that. We've talked. But I would rather see us all working in unison, and if there are problems, let's correct them and let's make it right. But I think we ought to do that. I mean, it's just you get more forward movement by cooperation, collaboration, communication than we do fighting. And this is the part I despise. I hate this, Frank. I hate it. And I love the city, and that's why I sit here.
Thanks, John. Mayor?
I've already talked too much.
Okay, thank you. Okay, with that being said, this meeting is adjourned. And following this, immediately following, we have a Kentwood City Council Town Hall meeting, calling to order the income tax, income tax rate.